This will be a 2.5D platformer with stealth elements similar to Ratatouille and Little Nightmares, where the player will be tasked to save his fellow rats from being cooked by the evil chief. As well as the environment, the player will be able to use unique rat advantages, like his speed and size. He will be able to move through small areas and rat holes that typical character wouldn't be able to fit. Apart from trying to save his rat friends, the player will also have to have in mind the chief. If he manages to disturb him, he will be able to buy some time to find a way to save other rats. The game takes place in the chief's house in a semi-dark mood, blending horror with a comedy in a tension-evoking gameplay. The game will be created for a variety of platforms, starting with PCs, PlayStations and Xboxes, and aiming to fit into PEGI 12 rating, as the game will introduce some realistic looking violence and a horror content within allowed frames of this rating. The game will start in some part of water supply network, where the player will be introduced the basic mechanics, like movement, interactable objects or some quick time events, while going towards the end of the tunnel that leads to the basement of the chief's house. In the basement, in addition to the mechanics and the story that the player learned so far, we will reveal another mechanics, which is breaking glass using a key, tomato catapult and basic crafting. We will also present the chief looking for some rat soup ingredients around the basement. The player will have to stay away from his field of vision and not make too much noise. Otherwise, the chief will start looking up for the noise source and then chase our main character if he spots him. If he catches the rat, he will put him into the cage and the player will have some time to escape before the chief would come back and eat him. One of the design pillars is stealth. That can be created in a few different ways. By using lights and shadows, by wearing a tomato box or a can skin, or by creating smoke. The player can be also invisible to the chief if he is in one of the hideouts. Let's start from the lights and shadows. If the player is in a lit area, he can be spotted from a bigger distance, and hence he can get caught and fail the level easier. If he is in shadows or hideout, he is almost invisible to the chief, as long as he is not making noise. If the player is in a semi-dark area, the chief has an average field of vision. In practice, I've implemented it according to the stealth bar. If the player is invisible, the field of vision gets to average size. If the player is in the lit area, the field of vision is doubled. The stealth can be created by destroying the lights or creating smoke in allowed areas, giving the player higher chances of not being spotted, which we'll implement in the main level. Noise mechanic. Apart from being cautious about whether or not we are visible, the player will have to be careful not to be too loud. Otherwise, even though the chief doesn't look in the rat's direction, he can drag attention and be spotted while the chief would check the noise source area. The player character movement includes crouching, walking, running and jumping. Each of them creates different noise amount, and each of them also takes into account the distance from the chief. Closer equals louder, which means a higher chance of being spotted. Catapult. This will be a very handy tool to craft out of different parts. Consists of the base, which can be a bottle or a can, arm, which can be a spoon, fork or a piece of wood, something to tie the parts together, which can be a rope or a spring, and a projectile, which can be anything that size is less than our main character, like tomato or sugar cube. To craft it, the player will have to collect all needed parts in a proper place and then put them together. Catapults can be used to create stealth by taking down the lights or distracting the chief by shooting at him or destroying something that drags his attention, or to destroy some obstacle that blocks the way to a particular area. To release the projectile, the player will have to jump on one end of the catapult or push some object on it. The core loop in the game will be introducing new area with new possibilities, introduce fresh mechanics. Old ones combined with new ones will give the player freedom to complete the level in his style. Use known mechanics to solve the puzzles, distract the chief, release the rat from cages, and then take them to the safe area. We had two main inspirations. Ratatouille, a platform game about a rat called Remy that wants to cook food for the people, but because he is a rat, he is put in deadly danger from humans. Firstly, we liked the environment and almost warm visual style. That was the base for our initial idea. Secondly, the game presented a very interesting mechanics, like for example the spoon launcher, that we would like to enhance and use in our project. Another inspiration was The Little Nightmares, a 2.5D horror side-scroller depicting the story of a little girl called Six that tries to escape from the weasel full of nasty creatures that would love to eat her. In this piece of art, we admired the connection between the visuals with the audio and the suspense in which the game holds us all the time. This game evokes the feeling of anxiety and shivers on the neck in the way it is designed, which is why it's a great position to draw inspirations that we can implement in our project. If we base the environment, the lighting colors and overall mood similar like in Little Nightmares, but only in certain situations, we could teach the player when to expect danger. Which doesn't mean the hazardous situation will occur. For example, in Little Nightmares, when you walk past from room to room, you can hear some murmurs along with tensive music, which puts the player in the state of alert. According to Kremers, level designers need to interpret the new rules of the world and teach them to players in such a way that it creates a great sense of wonder as well as teaching them how to play the game. Following this principle, we would like to gradually teach the player new mechanics and elements of the game and allow him to master them and combine with already known mechanics. If we add multiple ways to go through one stage and almost every object interactable, thereby freedom of choice. As a result, we could get an excellent game experience. For example, at the first stage we teach the player basic movement, pushing objects that can be used as a way to next area. We also show that the player can bite or destroy some elements to make their way through, and that they can craft simple tools that could help to progress. This presents what can be expected in the game and use it in the next level, where the player has to build a catapult using already known skills. Push object to the area, collect all required elements, craft catapult, then jump on it to release the projectile. If the challenges are too hard, the player will become frustrated. If they are too easy, the player will become bored. Having that in mind, we didn't want to create just a straightforward game. We wanted to make use of almost every corner of the designed level to give a feeling of space and that the player has a choice. So the player will have to show the problem-solving skills, but at not too frustrating level. For instance, we want to create upgrades for the catapult. The first instance is just one-shot tool, but later we could find new recipe for it and add wheels to make it movable, or some viewfinder to actually aim at the targets. The first catapult that the player faces is a very simple toy that stands still and shoots in one direction and cannot be moved because it's too heavy for the rat to push. If the player fails to hit the broken crate with tomato projectile a few times, it just breaks itself. I would call it protection against frustration, because we teach the player mechanics of the catapult. If he fails to reach the crates with a very first version of a catapult at the end of the second level, the game helps him and destroys them, because they were weak anyway. So that he will not get too frustrated if he fails to shoot all three crates in, let's say, 8 attempts. But at the same time, he knows how to build and use the catapult, as it is a part of introduction level. While the game progresses, and the player masters the mechanics, the game will not be that helpful and will require the player to show his skills and creativity. Rules of play. Meaningful play in a game emerges from the relationship between player action and system outcome. If I understand it right, to create a meaningful play, every action that the player takes should have some meaningful outcome, something that leads him to progress. Following this rule, I've implemented the level where every object and an interactable element of the environment leads him to complete the level. For example, there are a bottle and tomato spawn places, which are elements of the catapult in different parts of the level, as well as single instances of projectiles and catapult bases, like bottles and cans also scattered around the level, with multiple usages. They can be dropped from some height to drag Chief's attention or be dragged in a catapult crafting position, etc. So if the player decides to drop the bottle or a can and drag Chief's attention as a result, he can safely wander around another area where he can also progress. If he decides to drag the bottle to the catapult place area, he risks more but also leads to progress in a more risky way. There is a lot of mechanics and systems that have to work together to fulfill our project assumptions, from movement through hideout and simple crafting to Chief's AI. I would like to highlight a few of them that were problematic. One of them was to program the camera. After all, it takes a huge part in how the player perceives and experiences the game. To get the best possible results, we've tested different approaches. And so, the FPS camera collided with our 2.5D platform concept, so we could show the creepy chief appearing in front of our player character from nowhere that would multiply sudden shiver emotions, like when the Slenderman appears in the game suddenly, but with the cost of the puzzle solving possibilities. Similar with third person camera. We decided only to use it within special events like sliding down the slope or running away from chasing us chief and some quick time events. We didn't even think about top-down view camera, as it would destroy our plans of creating a tension similar like in Little Nightmares. It just didn't feel right, and we would not achieve desired tensive effect. Our last shot was a static camera that looks at the player, and it turned out to be a good choice, and we could both show the creepiness of the chief and implement our 2.5D puzzles, without losing the emotions of uncertainty and suspense. I had a huge problem of how to easily implement the cameras for certain areas, not losing the chief from our vision sight. My first shot was to create colliders for each area of the kitchen with the camera and simple look at the player script attached, which worked well, but at some point I could not control the rat and at the same time monitor the chief's position as the cameras were snapping from area to area. So for example, when I was looking at the whole kitchen but stepped into another area, the camera swapped and I didn't have a clear vision of a threat, and hence it was harder to navigate through the kitchen and important targets. After I've done some research, I found the solution in Unity manual. In essence, the solution for snapping the cameras with losing sight for essential targets was to smoothly move the camera from point to point using the vector3.lerp command. Thanks to that simple script, I ended up with only one camera that keeps looking at the player, but when he steps into another area, the camera just lerps to the new position, not losing its target from the side, and that made the camera transition smooth and eye-pleasing. Its implementation was very simple, as it consists only of one collider that triggers the transition and an empty transform that represents the new camera position as its parent. When I had the camera system sorted, I had to carefully place triggers in proper positions, not to lose the sight and the game experience. So I fell into the iteration circle for quite a long hours to set the camera positions to give the best possible view to the current player's position. As simple as it may seem, just to set the cameras was quite a challenge, as the gameplay and suspense that we want to create, among others, rely on the camera position. Secondly, I would like to split into parts Chief AI elements that I struggled with. The base for our bad guy AI is movement. I started with a very basic waypoint system, and then I set spheres around the level just to visualize the endpoints for Chief's movement. I found this tricky, as I could not easily just to stop the chief's movement in the place he stands and then continue to his previous destination. Secondly, I had objects set in the level and another obstacles to walk around, and the chief was going to the point in a straight line. So I needed to find another solution, something that would allow me to calculate the path needed to reach the destination, so I've started researching some other solutions. I spent some time looking up for the best possible ways, and I found a few tutorials and materials about the NavMesh, which in short is a surface on which our characters can walk or navigate through the game world. I learned how to use it, and I found it very easy and useful to control the enemy. I just need a few lines of code without a lot of tricky algorithms. If I want to stop the chief, I just need one line of code using the stop function, or resume if I want to continue to the current destination.
Now the chief's movement looked more natural, and whatever object was marked as a navmesh obstacle with Krev checkbox ticked, which will make a hole in the navmesh, will be avoided by the chief. In other words, the area that the navmesh obstacle covers are taken off the navmesh and hence make it not walkable. As a result, when calculating the path to the next destination, the navmesh will not include an obstacle area when doing math. As I studied navigation mesh deeper, I was also thinking about picking a random point within a radius of the chief's current position and set it as next destination point. However, I wanted to have a little bit more control over where the chief would go next, and I did not want to make it too complex, at least not yet. The issue that I am currently facing is that when the player character is evading out of the navmesh surface, the chief gets crazy and freezes in one state and doesn't move. I think this is because he cannot calculate the path outside the navmesh. I found the possible solution to calculate the closest edge of the navmesh where the player left baked surface. In the team, we work in agile project management framework and we keep updating the project when necessary. To stay in touch, we're using WhatsApp group chats as well as Discord, so we are in contact 24/7 and everyone is up to date with the project and new ideas. Our basic routine is to meet up, set the goals for next week, set the board, do our tasks, discuss the progress and potential changes, update our chunks of work. Apart from that, when needed, we are making extra meetings, so that we are updated every day about the progress and we are trying to deliver the best possible product in an effective way of working together as a group. Initially, we used GitHub repositories to update our work, but it was hard to use for some of us, so we've decided to upload our work on Google Drive, which was easy to use and access to everyone. Finally, I could not forget to mention our main tool for creating the actual game, Unity Game Engine. With all that arsenal of tools, we were and are well prepared to finish the project and for any other changes in a split second. The goals for the following weeks, as for my role, a programmer, is to improve the chief's AI scripts and debug them, so that all my pieces of code work perfectly together as one complex system. For example, my very next task is to solve the problem of the player evasion when out of the navmesh surface, and as the player has the freedom of spawning, moving and interacting with the objects, I would like to implement another state for the chief that triggers when there are too many objects thrown on the floor, then he gets suspicious and looks around every corner of the level to find the rodent. I would also like to restrict the number of spawn bottles and tomatoes that can exist on the scene at the same time. When I fix major bugs, I would like to take care of the main kitchen level. I planned it to be very complex, but because of lack of time, I will probably make just a demo of what could be expected in full version of the game to fit into the given deadline. Here's the weekly breakdown of what was done so far and what we are planning to do in the following weeks. And that's all for this presentation. Thanks for your attention. See you soon.